अभी लाइव और वी आर नॉट
लाइव
वी आर लाइव आई एट माय डैड्स
वी आर नॉट नॉट ऑन द फेसबुक यट कैन आई शेयर माय स्क्रीन एंड शेयर इट विल बी सीन
नो डोंट नॉट डोंट डू इट नाउ इटसेल्फ जस्ट
इधर प्रेजेंटेशन इस तरह ही मनाया नहीं मैंने कहा चैट का क्या नहीं
क्या आई प्रिपेयर टू स्लाइड द शेयर यस आई
डिड ब्रिंग एनीथिंग
यस नाउ वी हैव 27 अटेंडीज जॉइनिंग विद शार्पली 3 o'clock मिस्टर निस्ता यू कैन स्टार्ट सेशन
ओके
3 minutes मोर
Maybe Dilip, you can give the what the industry can do for the second question.
Industry can do at this time.
No, yeah, that yeah. Can for the second follow-up question, you can start from there.
From this, I thought this would actually set us like intro level.
Yeah, no, up to that last one, I think it was okay. It's right. A status update, but way forward, I think we'll keep it for the second one.
Okay, the last one. Okay, fine.
The last one. Okay. Way forward, or what we can do is like
yeah,
the third
moving from. Let's see. Yeah.
Is Gayani coming on board? Hi, webinar of organized by the European Chamber of Commerce of Sri Lanka and the Chartered Institute of Logistics and Transport. This is part of the COVID shutdown, and I have got an interesting subject today: rethinking tourism amidst and maybe post-COVID as well. And today we have three eminent industry personnel or professionals. Some insights. We have Dilip Mudadaniya, Vice President of John Keells and Head of Brand Marketing, Cinnamon Hotels and Resorts. I have Shromal Khure, managing director of Jetwing, and Dr. Rohan Thattukorala, a former chairman of the Sri Lanka Tourism and currently the CEO of Cool Track Sri Lanka Maldives. I'd like to welcome everyone on this webinar. Let's see what the experts have to say in terms of rethinking the whole tourism, which is a very critical industry for Sri Lanka as well as globally. I'll start this webinar by inviting Dilip to sort of give a status update. How bad is the situation locally and globally? And then we'll move on to Shiroma thereafter.
Thank you, Nista, for that. Well, I will basically start with something like a quick snapshot of not that how bad, but how good the tourism industry is. I know it's bad timing, but I hope everyone can see the screen. If you look at the entire rival country of the tourism industry, global tourism industry, despite many challenges, there's one underlying truth which has come into effect, is that it has grown over the years. Because the travel is part and parcel of living. Apart from shelter, food, jobs, etc., what you do, everyone has the desire to travel. And as a result, for business or other purposes, travel and tourism industry has grown over the years. It has its own setbacks. If you look at it in 2009-10, when the global economic recession took place, but it's actually took off. So the silver line here is that it's a matter of time. Always tourism has bounced back. You know, it's like a tennis ball in a water, it always comes up, and it's, you can't keep it down for a long time. So that's a good news for all of us. And that's something actually we should keep in mind when you're planning, etc. So, but on the other hand, if you look at this particular exercise, this is actually done by Forward Bookings. In terms of the bookings that were made on the first quarter, Asia Pacific, there's a 96.8% drop. It is quite understandable. People have stopped this traveling, and they have made their plans to stay in their houses. Safety is number one. And you know, it sees the Asia Pacific is the most hit area out of the all area, including South Asia. So we will see the people, they're not booked in during the first quarter. We will certainly see this impact going to continue for the two or three quarters more. Beyond this, you know, how do we see how long this whole impact will last? Currently, frankly, I don't think anybody can tell you how long it's going to last, because some destination, it stops, it comes back, and then goes back again. And, you know, you don't know how this is going to actually evolve. So on the basis that it started in February and it's going to be end up in 6 months, then the calculated impact by the tourism economy is around 55%. If the impact is going to last till September, and only in September this is going to last, the estimated impact to global tourism is around 73%. And if that goes on till November, it's going to be 87%. It goes till January, then the next year impact is going to be 93%. What is going to impact? And then if it's going to be actually 18 months, then we will have actually almost, we can say, tourism doesn't exist for that period. So this is actually scenarios that we are working on. Those scenarios will have to be evaluated month on month and understand. But somebody wants to see a light of end of the tunnel. I think the most feasible, optimistic one is going to be that, you know, we have some sort of hope by September, which we are still looking at about 73% drop in overall. This is basically some sort of indication we call V curves that we have seen during the Asia Pacific when we had the global economic recession. So Asia is actually known for this V-shaped growth. If you look at Strauss, you know, it came down to minus 15% and went up the next year by 27.8. Then the global financial crisis actually dropped, and then, you know, 0.8 only and went up by 12. But what is important to understand is that this particular COVID-19, the impact on tourism, is actually much larger than GFC, or much larger than SARS, or even larger than the impact from 9/11, or even put it together, it's much larger than all three disasters put it together. So that's the first time that we are facing as an industry. If you are analyzing it further, this whole impact has three elements that we call it: the peak, plateauing, and then the recovery. So that's earlier slide, which is linked to that. You know, plateaus can actually go up to about September. And if from September onwards, if you see a decline, then we'll see some sort of a normalization in countries, removal of the barriers, and people still thinking of domestic travel, etc., moving towards from December. And this is how the typical market will work, and hope this might be useful for your overall plan. So again, in terms of timelines, if you look at it, the first point is actually easing of restriction. Without restrictions being taken out, you can't even think of tourism. Without curfew being taken out or airport being open, I mean, these are necessary factors to safeguard the destination. Once this is over, only they can even think of it. After you easing the restrictions, you will take about another month, month and a half for domestic travel confidence to come in. And then you have the flight resumptions will start coming after another month or so. Then you may see the FIT travels will start slowly coming in, small number of packs, but it's been a little longer from the FIT's arrival to the group travel or the volume travel or the tour operator driven travel comes in. It's going to be unfortunately a little longer than that. And that's what they say. This would take actually a little longer than what we expected to recover. So keeping in mind, it's like a snapshot with everyone is asking when this is going to be over. The answer is nobody knows, but we only have some scenarios. The best scenario we would look at is September. The worst scenario, we can even go beyond 6 to 8 months beyond that point. So hopefully, fingers crossed, we might be able to mitigate this situation earlier than that.
Okay, thanks, Dilip. Thanks for that introduction. I move on to Shiroma. Give me a local context to this global phenomenon.
Okay, so I want everyone. What I can say is in Sri Lanka right now, according to the immigration and immigration, there are about 12,000 tourists in the country. I think some of them are people who have been staying here long term. Others may be tourists who have decided to stay on in the country because rather than going back to their own countries. I'm not sure where exactly these people are. I can say on behalf of our hotels, we have two hotels with maybe 10 rooms in one hotel, another one with two rooms. Other than that, everything else is having zero occupancy. And I think that is the same for most other hotels as well. I think some of the hotels are closed. Some of the Colombo hotels are open. But most hotels that I know of and our hotels are working with a small staff who are going under quarantine restrictions. So they are working in 2 week periods. And they are maintaining the hotel, the plant and machinery and doing all of that. In addition to that, they are also doing, we've always been doing cultivation and other related activities. So they have intensified that. And we are actually thankful for our managers who have been staying with the teams at the hotels, even during the Singala New Year period, as far back in Yala, Damulla, wherever. So they've been amazing a lot. And so they're doing cultivation. We have a hotel in Vallavaya, which does farming. So right now they've done the maha cultivation, the harvesting, and we have got about 40 kilograms of rice. So, I mean, we are continuing what we've done before as well amidst all of this. So at the moment, then we have our inbound and outbound departments, with obviously zero arrivals. So it's a case of having expenses without any revenue. And as Dilip said, it's something that none of us have ever experienced before. But we have to, as he also rightfully said, we will survive. So we have done a lot of cost cutting, restructuring, and even our pay salary cuts were done bottom up. It was not a top down decision. Hiran had spoken to the general managers of the hotels, and it was actually one of the GMs that came up with this proposition. And so that has been accepted by everybody. And we are hoping that by doing all this, renegotiating our contracts and doing all of that, we will be able to keep our costs to a bare minimum and keep our teams, because, you know, our teams are our biggest asset. They've done an excellent job for JetBlue. They've done, maybe they're well trained, they know our culture. So we want to keep them. That's our biggest asset. We will do whatever in our power to keep them and wait for the time to come. And I think you're going to ask me what you're going to do next. But this is the current situation, Mr. Things are not very positive at the moment. But as Dilip said, tourism is something that's going to come back. All human beings have a necessity or a tendency to wanting to meet each other, to talk to each other, to explore. The curiosity will remain. And I think there are three sets of people, if I may take a little more time. There is one set who are paranoid, you know, I don't think they're going to get into a plane for the next 2 years, whatever, come what may, even with a vaccine, they will not. I think there are another lot who will be fairly, I would say they'll be cautious, but they'll be rational about their decisions. You know, they will weigh the pros and cons and make decisions. Then there's another lot who just wouldn't give a damn. They just will wait for the curfews to be lifted, for the travel restrictions to be taken off, and they'll just travel. You know, so it's these three lots that we are, I think, dealing with. And again, as Dilip said, once the countries are willing to let their people travel, once Sri Lankans are ready to accept tourists, once the airlines are ready to fly, then I think we can look at the next phase.
Thanks, Shurumal. Dilip, is it possible to give a John Keel Cinnamon Resorts hotels context? How many hotels are closed?
The issue is that since the curfew is in place, there are no clients coming either for F&B or airport is also closed. There's nobody coming in. So we have a partially closed. There are people in the hotel, but we have stopped taking any reservations till 30th of April because we are to respect the current situation in the country and help them. And so as a result, there aren't any guests in any of the hotels. So we are partially closed. If anyone comes in, we'll take care of them, but we don't have any occupancy as such in the hotel. So that's, we believe, will be the case till end of the month, and once it's improved, we'll take decisions appropriately.
Okay, interesting. 30th of April, that's like next week. Are you saying that you might, if the situation improves, there will be some demand for some bookings?
If the current curfew situation continues, and then we don't really see how people, it's not essential service, so people will not be able to come to hotels. And there is no point of maintaining and keeping the staff and running them at risk, etc. So as far as the ground situation improves for hotels and other non-essential sectors to operate, nobody will be able to operate and there's no point because there's no business and there are no clients. So we will evaluate it and see, and this is the original decision, but if that curfew continues, then we need to wait until curfew is lifted and the situation improves for us to go back to what it was, maybe starting with restaurants and so on.
Okay, fine. Thanks. Thanks for putting in context. I move on to Rohantha. What's your own take on the states of the industry?
Nista, it's not only just tourism, exports, or even if you take manufacturing, which in all three areas I'm involved in. The fact of the matter is that it's all about money and bodies. Now, if you open the economy quicker, you can get money on the table, but then you'll have more bodies in the country. So that's why they call this the hammer and dance model. So you lock down for this 21 days, 39 days and 49 day models, and then you see whether you can curtail the spread, and then you open the economy for the economy to dance. So we have to decide what is that model that we're going to use in Sri Lanka. Now, if you take Mexico, they're very clear. They said, we are locking down the whole economy because our algorithm tells us that end of the April, it will peak, and then the virus will die down if it's in the body between the days of 14 and 16 days. So are we going to wait till the 16 days and then open the country up so that then we can get into dance? So that's the challenge. You know, it's a maths game. It is not actually to do with a particular industry. Second point I like to make next day is, end of the day, let's assume this virus goes off today. Tomorrow you'll have all the tourists flocking to Sri Lanka. There is no problem with our product. Our product is good. People are waiting to come to Sri Lanka. So it's a logistical issue that we have here. So we got to understand that, you know, the challenge is about, you know, how the policymakers decide when they are going to open the market and then take a call saying, okay, if you open today, you'll have 300 people dying, or whether it's in the US, they are saying 3 lakhs are dying. So you have to do a computation. And it's a very Nazi kind of an approach, but that's what it has come to.
Fine, thank you. Interesting thoughts. I just want to know, the biggest concern is the, as Shurumal mentioned about the team, the staff. What's the status? You said they are on, how are you managing with the challenge of keeping, retaining them, number one, and also, managing the cost in terms of you know, retaining them?
You're asking minister?
Yeah, that's right.
So as I said, we have all of us have taken pay cuts. I mean, Hiran and I are not taking a salary, but everybody else has taken a pay cut depending on the amount of money they are earning. And so we are managing, and as I said before, all the other costs also we have pruned down to the bare minimum. So we are hopeful that, and we have been communicating with our teams. They know the entire thing. We've been completely transparent with them. And we are confident they will stay with us as long. And we are also confident that we will do our best. Unless it's absolutely necessary, we will not let a single one of them go. So we will keep them and they'll stay with us. We are fairly confident. We've had people with us for a long time. And as I said, our GMs at the hotels have been incredible. They've been staying with their teams. They've done a fantastic job. So we have no doubt about our teams, Anista.
Good. Is there a possibility to sort of give what kind of a number you had before COVID? And then what's the number now? And where do you see with the kind of forecast that will take 6 to 8 months to recover? Would you be looking at more shedding going forward?
No. As I said, that would be the last thing we would do. But having said that, we are also managing hotels, Anista, that don't belong to us. So in those instances, we have to respect the wishes of the owners. And if some owner asks us to reduce the staff or maybe take off the casual staff or probationary staff, then we have to respect them. So sometimes we have done that, but not in our own hotels. But some of the managed hotels, yes, we are looking at such things. But we are confident we can keep them. And I think you were talking about the domestic market. Jetwing has always been fortunate in having a fairly good Sri Lankan clientele, local and expats. Even in the good old days, we've had about 25% Sri Lankan market. So we are very confident that they will come back to us. And I do agree that even their purchasing power will be less because I think most of them also have had salary cuts. But even after the bomb attack last year, they came and they kept the hotels going. The staff were kept up and they were getting tips and service charge. So that was a good sign. And we've always respected our local market and we've always had offers for them and had a very good relationship. So we are confident that in the short term, the domestic market will return. And that is what we need to focus on right now. So we are getting our plant ready with the new requirements or the new normal about masks and health and hygiene and all of that. So we are now starting to train our teams on those requirements so that when the ground is ready for people to travel, we will be ready to accept them with our, you know, with what we are known for. We are also doing some food delivery from our hotel in Colombo, which is very well accepted, and we're very thankful to the people for doing that. That is keeping that team really motivated and going. So in the medium term, hopefully, maybe the regional markets may come back. Even Dilip said about September, but I'm not that optimistic. Maybe around December, hopefully. Maybe China, India, South Korea, Japan may open up. Again, I'm not sure whether our Sri Lankans will be ready to accept. If they are, if they have the proper mechanism going, maybe the regional market will open up in the medium term, and Europe and other markets I think will be in the long term, maybe 12 months from now.
Okay. Dilip, what's the cinnamon human capital situation in terms of how I'm managing the numbers? You have a large number. How many are same sort of, I know there was a pay cut announced, but have they been sent home? Are they being retained and like being trained?
No, I think nobody has been sent home. And even if you look at our East attacks, you know, I mean, we took care of the staff very well. And you know, even the salaries were paid without any reduction, even including the average service charge they were getting. So the employees are very, very important from a group point of view. And they've been actually taken care of. Obviously, cash is king at this point. When the zero occupancies are there, we need to make sure that how we manage it. So as responsible organizations for the shareholders, certain measures have been taken on reduction of a certain percentage of salaries based on a certain people, but not anyone earning below 50,000. So their salaries have not been reduced. Others from zero to a certain percentage has been reduced. So apart from that, there's a very focused attention on managing the cash, the capital expenditure. These are basic OFEs, prudent measures that any organization will take place in order to protect the cash situation. The cash is king at this time. We need to manage the situation for a foreseeable future. We don't know how long, 3, 4, 6, maybe 1 year. So those measures have been taken there. So we are looking at, you know, it's evolving situation. So we are not in a hurry to take decisions. Maybe we will, the situation will be assessed on month basis and will be taken. So far, the employees are there. The basic maintenance is taking place in hotels. So no sooner the curfew situation is over, and then you can actually think of starting Colombo, you know, with F&B operation. And as Sirumal said, it's not going to be September. Even the, what I said was the September is, if the whole impact is over in September, or the decline started in September, from there itself take another 2 months, 2 to 3 months, even to normalization and removal of restrictions. From there, the domestic travel will, I know, get that conclusion, will take about 2 months. From there only you will have the another 2 months later. So you're essentially looking at even December, January, February, where you have some sort of a hope at coming in. But having said that, we don't know how the market behaves. But as any other group done, I think we've taken prudent steps to safeguard the cash flow situation and to navigate this period, as we have done it several times in the past.
Fine. No, let me, we listened to an apparel industry leader saying that even with pay cuts going forward, the outlook is very grim in terms of they won't be able to even pay salaries. I mean, I know pay cut has been implemented, but how long can you go on even with that pay cut when we have zero revenues? I mean, let's be realistic so that everyone takes note of the real gravity of the situation.
So Nista, I think for the garment industry, perhaps this may be about the second time that they've really faced a crisis like this. And I think their numbers are also very large, and their pay amount quantum is also quite large, because they have a lot of people at the tail end, you know, less than 50,000. There's a whole heap of people. So tourism is a little bit different in that sense. And our numbers, well, the whole industry has about 500,000 people working, and the salary bills are perhaps not that high as in the garment industry. And again, we have gone through this before. And as Dilip said, we are used to curtailing our expenses. We are used to kind of what they call hibernating and waiting for good times to come. So I think we have had some experience to manage it, although we've never had this kind of an experience before. But we feel that we should be able to curtail and stay as long as possible. And that is why we took a cut immediately. We thought it was prudent to do immediate cost cutting, and we have done that. And we will keep monitoring. As somebody said, every day it changes. I mean, even the curfew, today we are told it's going to be lifted tomorrow. And I mean, that's natural, that's normal. It's going to happen, it's going to be the future. So we will keep monitoring. And as I said, we will do our best to keep our team. But if a time comes, and we are confident as at now, we can. But if it changes, then things will have to be done then. And again, as I said, some of the managed properties, they have asked us to cut the staff. So we are doing that. And also our labor laws does not allow us to also terminate right now. So I think those are also issues that one has to look at. But I think some people may find it difficult to manage. But I guess it has to be, each one has to take. Somebody said the storm is the same, but the boat we are in will depend how we weather the storm, you know. So some may be in a little stronger boat, some may be in a weaker boat. Depending on that, we each of us will have to weather it.
Okay. What you're saying is that for the next 6 months, the larger groups will not lay off. Is that what you're saying?
No, I'm not saying that. I don't know. I don't know really. I can talk on our behalf. We will, as I said, we will do our best to keep them as long as we can, and we are hoping it will be only 6 months. It may even be an year. But as I said, that is our biggest asset. So we never want to let go of our asset. We will take care of them and keep them.
Right. There is this industry request that government sort of make some arrangements to finance, to pay the salaries for 6 months. I mean, is that feasible? How practical, and or how serious is the need for cash given no revenue?
The need is very dire, Vista. I mean, if the government can do that, that's going to be a great help for the big and small, for everybody. But I think we have to also be practical. I don't think our government or the country also has money, you know, so we need to be also aware of that. But if it can be arranged, that's going to be a great help, and definitely it will help everybody to manage their cash and carry on longer.
Well, Dilip, any idea from you?
Same thing. All the associations, over 32 more associations in tourism, not only accommodation, tour operators, travel agents, but the boat providers, the guides and the national chauffeur guides. So many people have asked for the various concessions, and then those have been, I believe, submitted to the National Tourism Authority. But the question is, it's very good that if this thing comes in, and it will be really helpful for the industry. But as Shiromal said, practicality of giving this from a government perspective are yet to be seen whether it comes or not. So that's why I think we need to take this kind of a discussion into how do we move beyond this issue. You know, I mean, it's understood the impact is greater. We have not seen before. Economic impact is far greater, and survival is going to be very, very difficult and hard, and a lot of hard decisions have to be taken. Those are known factors. But the unknown factors also, they're the ideal time for us to look into that. You know, what kind of industry we want to build after this, more sustainable, profitable, and inclusive industry that should come into play, rather than, you know, what we had. So I think we also have to, very important that we look beyond the recovery, mere recovery, and try and see whether we actually can restart and some re-engineer some of the concepts that we have in place, make use of this time.
Okay, fine. Rohanta, any insights with regard to the human capital challenge?
I think, you know, we don't know what the, how this is going to pan out in the next 3 to 4 months. But I think there is one thing that all of us can do, which is how are we going to contribute to flattening the curve? I think the most single-minded task that every one of us, whether you at Daily FT or whether it be Shiromal or Dilip, is that how do we educate our people in our companies so that they understand the proper protocols to follow when they go to a supermarket? If the schools start or education institutes, what do you do? And in our companies, what do you do? Now, there is a Ministry of Health has developed a protocol. And I don't know how many of you all have seen this. It's a very comprehensive protocol. Now, our task is how do we take this to our employees and help them to practice it? Because if one of those guys get COVID, then it will go to his family. And once it goes to the family, it will start going to the community. And then, you know, this will go on and on for the next 1 year, which we have seen in certain markets. Now, for example, I mean, just to share a case in point, I mean, Rotary, which is having the largest project management organization, we have taken the role of taking these protocols into our members, and the members going in each of those towns to the supermarkets, schools, and the companies and saying, we will help you in this protocol. How do you implement? When a person comes to work, is there going to be a footpath? Is there going to be the temperature check? Then are you going to keep all the doors open? You know, don't keep every time somebody comes in and out, the doors to be touched. You know, don't have team meetings. Try your as possible to have meetings which are on the phone. Don't share phones, you know, intercoms. You know, you then make sure that no water is being shared, no food is being shared. Your lunch break happens from 11 o'clock till 3 o'clock so that you go in batches. So now if we don't follow these protocols, all these glandular things that we talk is useless, because you know, you know, every country has this thing called stage one, which is no cases. Stage two, which is where you have sporadic cases. And then stage three and B is A and B is when the families, you have one person or the total family. And finally, you have the whole community. Now in Sri Lanka, 60% of Sri Lanka is in stage two or stage one, actually, no cases. And then you have other 40%, which is having, which are in the red zones and who are having two or three. Now the question is, now this is the data which we have, Nista, because that is the amount of people we test. Now, if the testing increases, obviously this number might change, but then we got to work with the data which we have. No? So from this data, Nista, you have to decide, how do you manage this? Now, Gampa is seeing a spike in the last 3 days. There's a spike in Sri Lanka, Colombo. Now, what have we done to mitigate this on our own? You know, so nobody talks about this, you know. So that is what the challenge is.
Understood. Okay, thanks. Thanks for all the panelists. We are beginning to get some questions, which also my round two in terms of what the industry can do. So there's some specific question: what would be the short and long term strategy that the industry need to look post COVID destination marketing? Dilip, any ideas? Medium and long term.
Yeah, I think. Obviously, I mean, it's very important that we fight the short-term impact of this, you know, through various ways. Each organization has to fight their own battle, plus any support that comes in from the government or any other agencies would be actually very, very useful and I think very necessary at this time. So having set aside that, there seems very important that we know we establish something called purpose-driven tourism. What is the real purpose of tourism for a destination? You know, it's basically one of the core requirements is the foreign exchange earnings. So these foreign exchange earnings quantum and the quality and the impact needs to be assessed. So it has to be like a more sustainable and profitable industry. And if actually investors are keep on investing and there's no return on the industry, even in a good term, then we need to look at, say, what happened to the yield and what happened to the business models, etc. So that needs to be rethink. And the second one is actually what kind of a customer experience once this is actually improved, the situation, you know, within a year, you know that it's going to come up. And what are we going to give it? And are we still actually looking at congestion and customer experiences that are not really good enough for the destination? It's time for us to rethink on this and work out. And the third one is actually your marketing strategy. We know that in coming September, October, November, you're going to have 100 countries battling over that 1.2 billion, you know, which we only have about 20%, at least not even 8% of arrivals South Asia. So every country is after these stories. So how do you differentiate yourself and how do you put it back on the map for them to come in? And then also we can't really think the marketing itself is the only solution that's going to be there. There has to be some other areas that we have to work on collectively to get the tourism into the level that we want, what we call purpose-driven tourism. So we need to work on those lines parallelly. And there's a lot to be planning perspective, lot done. There's a lot to be done from an execution perspective to bring that execution excellence into the organization, because even tomorrow, if COVID is finished, are we ready? The answer is not really there. So this make use of this time to bring that core elements into it and basically look beyond the recovery. That's my message.
We see companies, some of the companies sort of really engaging with the customers. Is that, has that happened in the industry? Even through WhatsApp, is the Sri Lanka tourism hotels sort of inquiring about the safety of their own guests who are here? What about the repeat visitors? Is that happening on a large scale when you said purpose-driven tourism?
Yeah. So when I say purpose-driven tourism, when I say what I talked about, the looking beyond the recovery and what kind of a tourism that, you know, we want to have in this country, it's time to think about it. And it's time to bring that ethos into place, because there are a lot of discussions taking place. And we saw during this time, there were about easily 10,000-12,000 tourists who are stuck. And I have seen in my own eyes that they don't even have money to pay for a hotel. So we have basically a situation where Sri Lankan families get 5,000 rupees for the whole month, where, you know, somebody has to subsidize hotel room, which is per day, is about 3,000-4,000 rupees minimum. So is that the type of tourism that we want to promote in the future? Is the type of industry that we want to have? So we need to deliberate that, and it's the time to think about it. So having said that, engaging with the customer and giving them the reasons is something which we need to do constantly. I mean, we as a group have been doing it, running this campaign we call See Now, Experience Tomorrow, and Travel Experience Later and Travel Tomorrow, so that you create vacation movies in the minds of people. One day they'll remember. It's very important. We have seen series of destinations, what they have done from Costa Rica to Australia. We have seen what airlines have done. So it's very important that, you know, destination and private sector all together and brands wise keep on engaging with the customers in different levels. So there's a credibility coming in. And those are basic steps in a brand management and marketing plans. So I believe everyone has to do it, but should look beyond that.
Is that widespread within the industry, or do we have an industry that keeps complaining?
I'll ask Shiromal. I spoke enough.
No, I think what Dilip says is correct. I think lots of people are engaging with their clients, with their cooperative partners, with their customers constantly. You know, I mean, not being a nuisance, but messaging them and keeping them engaged. I must say, in this instance, even our shop guides and guides are doing a great job. They are also, because they are the front line, they are the ones who have been talking to the clients. So they are also doing a great job keeping in touch, asking them, how are you keeping? You were here during this period. Are you okay? So that engagement is going already, Mr. And I think a lot of people are doing that. So we are not only complaining, we are also doing our best to keep the interest in Sri Lanka going. And so that as soon as the situation improves, people will be wanting to come. We are confident people will come when the situation normalizes, because there's a lot of interest still. People are writing to us. They are saying they can't wait to come back. I think it's the same with everybody. So as Dilip said, the product has not changed. It will only get better because the nature has really blossomed. The animals are there. The fauna, flora, you know, it's all flourishing. So the product will be at its best. But as he said, we need to get our other things, our infrastructure ready. Like, for example, Sigiriya, the national sites can be developed, we can have systems in place to streamline all those processes. But this is a good time to do that. There are lots of things like that, some of the housekeeping stuff, which even the state can do with the help of the private sector. Private sector is ever willing to do that. If that can be done and streamlined so that there is no over-visitation, there is, you know, proper management of crowds, then we will be definitely ready to take the new tourism, the people on when it happens.
Okay. There was reference to about regional markets. I think South Asia is relatively less affected. I don't know what the numbers are there, but so closer to home, it's a big market. You know, India is our second largest source market. What prospects do we have in terms of, you know, assuming things improve? Europe might take time to travel to come back, but looking at South Asia, Southeast Asia, you think there is greater scope? And if it is so, what should Sri Lanka be doing from now onwards?
Dilip, please go ahead.
Yeah,
you take it. That's okay, Sharma.
No, you're the marketing guru.
No, so basically, I think what we look at it, there's a little worrying factor here. The India would have been an ideal solution and a great destination for us. But unfortunately, situation in India is going to be a little scary at the moment. So it seems to be a little deeper. We don't know when the situation will improve. So with that context, whether we will open for India is not known. If India's situation improves, that's going to be a great hit. That's very important. China seems to be another option that we look at it, because people have started already traveling in China. There seems to be what we call, there's an emergence concept called revenge travel. So people actually, you know, to revenge, take the revenge they're traveling. And we've seen that domestic travel has increased by about 60% in China. Great Wall is full and the restaurants are full and so on. So Chinese have that power and the determination to travel. We also see resilient markets like Russia and the breakaway countries from that, you know, those are actually some of the countries which we can think of currently, which has a dominant effect. At the same time, in terms of demographics, the research actually shown that the millennials are actually going to be the ones which are also seems to be very open for traveling and during this time. So we need to look at those geographic areas. It's too little too early to say again, all will depend on your flight connectivity as well, how much of traveling that you have connection for these countries to these people to come in. The other option is we need to keep in mind is the what will happen to the visa and the is the border traveling. Will the European, the Schengen visa will remain as it is if they've taken it out, or if countries produce their own restrictions, what will happen to the traveling population of Middle East, for example? Do we have an opportunity with 6 hours of traveling? So those are all emerging factors we need to keep in mind. But what's more important is to be agile and have a mechanism where we quickly go and grab that opportunity, and we have to keep it ready so that, you know, we'll be able to make use of that opportunity without delaying.
Shiromal, you had some ideas as well.
I think Asia has been the fastest growing travel market in the world. So we are very fortunate to be in the midst of that. And we also have direct flights. Sri Lankan Airlines, as always, has been our savior, even during the war. They were the only airline that was flying. So I think I was listening to Vipula speak yesterday. They are very confident of doing flights from the region, especially direct flights, because people will be preferring to take direct flights rather than going via transit points. So if they have flights to China, to India, to Australia, so I'm sure all those places, along with Sri Lankan Airlines, if Sri Lanka Tourism does some a campaign at when the time is right, I'm quite confident that the Asian market will be our savior in the short term, or rather, sorry, in the medium term. But I think this is also ideal opportunity for us to relook at our Chinese market, because we have really messed it up. You know, we got the wrong tourist coming in, and it was really bad, and so much so some of the other travel agents were not going into the Chinese market. So I think maybe this is a time for the authority to SLTDA to get activated and look at the Chinese market and target the high-end traffic, as Dilip was saying, sorry, not a high-end, the high-yield traffic, who will be able to add value to the product and also leave some value to Sri Lanka's tourism.
Yeah, you brought the whole discussion to an interesting point. There is this talk, we were in an oversupply situation before COVID, rooms wise. And this currently, I think the oversupply is maybe, it's an understatement. is there a tendency, is it good to sort of in the short term go for a quantity versus quality? I want the panel to come in, because we're looking at recouping whatever what we lost, and should it be short term to medium term? Should we go for numbers, or should we just start fresh and go for more quality tourism?
I'm always for quality than for quantity, but I do agree with what you're saying. These are desperate times, and people will resort to desperate measures, no matter what the associations say. People will definitely, price is the only weapon they have. So they will compete on price, unfortunately, and which will sadly bring the entire thing down. And then getting those prices back on is going to be a really sad situation. But it is what it is, right? I'm sure that's going to happen. But personally, if you ask me, I would go for quality anytime than quantity.
Okay.
Sister, can I say something?
Yes, please.
See, I think, let's be very real here. We cannot look at tourism coming from overseas for the next, I don't know, maybe about 3 to 6 months. Let's be very real, because end of the day, we have 600 to 800 beds. And if the COVID cycle works, I get COVID. If I don't recover properly, I go to IDH or wherever. You know, then I feel more bad. I'm put into a ventilator, and then I will recover or I die. You know, so let's be real. So at the moment, we have 21 million people in Sri Lanka, and we have 800 beds. So if you ask me, if you look at a policymaker's point of view, tourism is going to be in the back burner at this moment of time. I'm trying to make sure that we make Sri Lanka secure, right? Okay. Secondly, we have 150,000 people out there, kids, who are waiting to come down, right? And, you know, they're crying out to come down. In UK, all over. There are some people stuck in Bangladesh, you know, a lot of our friends. So now we need to bring these guys down. So we have a lot of challenges right now. I think the focus of this industry should be very simple. it will be domestic tourism led. Now, domestic tourism will not come to play until we get our own companies secure and make sure we flatten the curve. I don't know how many companies know this. You know, if otherwise, what will happen is that this whole curve will pick up, and then, you know, there's no point looking back. Second point I'd just like to make, Nista, in a minute, would be that from a very marketing point of view, Sri Lanka will never get this chance again, like what Dilip and Chiramal were saying, to look at the strategy of our country. I mean, you'll never get this chance, you know, do a total proper audit. And I think I heard from the tourist board that there's an audit done by UNDP to understand the ASEAN situations. The last week, the cabinet has apparently approved this whole thing of the tourism marketing game plan. So a proper pitch to be done all over the world, get the proper strategy in going. I mean, Maldives has had 3 campaigns for the last 2 years, right? With just $9 million budget, right? So we need to get into that traction of proper destination marketing. And if we can be ready with this in the next 1 year, launch it. And like what Chiramal was saying, focus on a top-end target group. Sri Lanka will never get this chance again.
Yeah, fine. I'm still struggling with how do you fill the number, the rooms. That's the challenge. I think the industry is a bit divided on that. Just on the sticking to the Asian markets, do we have the right product to really bring back the Asians here? So we still lack entertainment, which is a very important attraction for the Indians. Maybe is it time to sort of fast track some of the options we have in entertainment, assuming things improve later on?
But things were moving up, Nista. We were getting a lot of Indians coming. There were Indian weddings happening here. The celebrities were coming here for their functions. And as things evolved, entertainment was also evolving. I mean, cinema did a lot of events, and even local companies did. So I think if we progressed the way we did, I'm sure things would have evolved. I don't think it's necessary for us to ape what other countries are doing. We are a small island, you know, of 21 million people, and how we have a certain number of tourists that we can take. So, and we saw how when one thing happened, how our communities were hostile towards tourists. And not only tourists, even our own employees, the tour guides, they were all, they were kind of ostracized. So we have to be careful also, you know. We need to take care of our people. So as long as our people can earn from it, and if they can provide a localized kind of entertainment, they have this entertainment in India, that loud music and dancing and all of that energy. Maybe they don't need that when they come here. Maybe they need to just chill out. Maybe they need something else. So let us see what we can offer, what we are good at, and offer it to them. And so if we're talking about long-term, wellness is an area where we can really promote, because I think Kimali kept speaking about Helaveda Kama. So there are a lot of Ayurveda systems that can help boost immunity. So maybe we can do those programs. Even we have Ayurveda Center, and that doctor is excellent at doing things to boost your immunity. So these are things that are unique to Sri Lanka. Well, not Sri Lanka, and maybe India as well. But let us focus on what we are good at and promote that rather than trying to ape. Indians can get it from Thailand, from Malaysia, from Singapore. So why would they want to come to Sri Lanka? So let's see why and try and maximize what we have.
Fine. Spoke about wellness. I saw some had proposed, and I think I saw some of the Sri Lankans who want to come back I think they've written to the president as well, saying they want to come back, but they will pay for the quarantine in the hotels if the need.
Perfect.
Yeah. Is that an emerging market? I don't know, Rohantha, maybe you also can come up. I mean, there is also a question, why can't we use hotels for quarantine with a price? But knowing that there were some situations where foreigners were not welcomed in certain village hotels, resorts areas, is that a wise move? Or how should you handle it?
I think most hotels have been offered Vista for quarantine purposes. I know we have offered. I know Hemas have offered. I think John Keels have offered.
This is monetizing that opportunity, not just free. But
yeah, no, they are. They are, it is monetized. They are willing to pay. I think I don't think the government is expecting free. They are willing to pay a certain amount, provided you fit into certain, follow certain protocols. And the health authorities and the forces will come in. So yeah, so that's a possibility going forward. Rohanta was saying there are so many students who want to come into this country. So government doesn't have to pay for their quarantine. You know, the parents can afford to pay for them to be brought into the country and kept for 14 days in a hotel with the basic facilities. So yeah, I think that's, those are possibilities that will happen. And most of us have offered our hotels for that purpose.
So, I mean, wellness, we have spoken a lot, and I think that's why we have a special wellness special focus in most of the marketing. What more can we do to really, in post-COVID, the safety, wellness, health is much more prominent. What more can we do on promotion, or can the government do something to really attract this segment?
Dilip,
Dilip,
so until he's get ready, I can say I think the tourist promotion.
Hello.
We can hear you, Dilip. You're on mute.
So I think one of the key things here is that after 10 years. We have seen a well-structured destination campaign has been authorized by the government. I think that's a giant step in the right direction. So we are, I think, as the board member of a promotion bureau, I think I saw the structure, etc. It's very impressive, and we need to make stay true, and everyone has to help in the industry to put that implementation, make it very effective. But approving it and have that broader vision is very, very important, and that has been first hurdle is actually passed. In that, where the process is concerned. The second thing we need to understand is the market reality. You know, currently 60% of our capacity is below 3-star in Sri Lanka. If you look at the rooms below 3-star category, and most of the rooms that have been constructed also below 3-star. So in a situation where the destination offering is most of the accommodation, etc., 3-star, having an understanding of get to the high yield, there's a mismatch in that. So we need to bridge that through policies and through discussion, etc. And it's very important that inclusiveness comes into play, and categorize the segments, etc. That's what we need. The third thing is that we know that we have a seasonality. You know, if you look at what are the segments that we want to approach, currently highest number of rooms that are added in Colombo, it's about 4,000 new rooms, and another part more about 10,000 apartments are being added, apartment rooms, which will also come to the market. And the Colombo essentially is going to be an appeal for the regional market. I don't think most of the leisure-based tourists from France or Germany or other countries will come in, but most probably India, the region, and the Middle East would be that traffic. So as you very correctly pointed out, Nista, that creating a product for these people to come and enjoy is something is very, very important. So I'll bring another point. We have 1.8 million square feet of shopping space that have been introduced to Colombo from now till end of the next year. Shangri-La, Cinnamon Life Mall, ITC, and so many other malls, and the Colombo City Center, all that coming in. But we are struggling to get brands in, so that we have actually now given, all the malls have given together a white paper to the government to consider to take the duty out of those brands, so that we become competitive and we can become a shopping destination. That is one of the reasons that the regional tourism actually will survive and people will come, like Singapore, Malaysia, and Thailand. So we need to create products like that. And it's very important note that all these proposals have been favorably considered. So as if these things come into play, then proactively we can actually work towards getting those regional markets in place. So we have to work together to achieve that, keeping in mind the product that we have is not really the upmarket product. There are some products, while most of the products are still catering to 3-star and below.
Yeah.
There is a nice model I mean, if we are, I yet keep saying that we are very far away from looking at tourism because we are trying to survive here. You know, we have to survive the next 3 days, the next 5 days, especially the spike areas, which is Kalambu, Gampaha, and Jaffna. But since you are looking at the future also, there is a model which is coming out from Thailand, where they are focusing only on the Chinese tourists, because of course, Thailand has about 60% Chinese coming in. So I think the way I see it, I mean, nobody knows what's going to happen in the future, but there might be controlled tourism coming to play globally. So you have discussions at a policy level with a country where they would do the COVID test and all that. They will do the first certification there, and then they will allow them to have reciprocal kind of exchange. And I think, like what Dilip was mentioning, I think China might be the people who are actually ready to get into this reciprocal, with, because we have strong political links also.
Good. I think the panelists also can see some questions from the audience who come. I just like to take maybe any one of you panelists can answer or pick up a particular question. But I'd like to come back to the SMEs. I mean, what's your advice? How can the SMEs manage this? I mean, I think they have less budgets, less management expertise, and the financial clout. How can the SMEs survive in this situation? Ramal, you being a financial advisor as well?
I know about that. So I think, as I said, each one is in a different boat, right? So
yes,
if you're small, then your size is small. And you should be, try to manage within that space. I think we need to all, as I was listening to something that the garment industry said, how they may have to take their lifestyles will have to be downgraded. So we need to be all aware of that. And as Rohanta said, we need to also discuss with our teams and explain to them the situation, and that, again, we need to really maybe downgrade our lifestyles. We need to have different realities about security and all of that, the safety. So I think if we do that, I'm sure, however big or small a company is, they should be able to try and manage to live within their means. And manage, you know, the teams will be fairly resilient. If you tell, I mean, they are also, unfortunately, at the moment, there aren't too many options. You know, people are cutting costs and they're not going to be hiring people. So I'm sure they'll be happy to have some kind of remuneration. So I think they should talk to them, work together with the team, come to arrangements, and manage. And I'm sure body will have some reserve. I don't think anybody, whether big or small, doesn't have a reserve, some kind of a reserve. Maybe personal even. Perhaps this is a time they need to maybe bring out some of that. I don't know, because if you're an entrepreneur and you want to, because I remember when my dad was an entrepreneur and he was just a single owner at that time. And when we started, we brought the cooker from our home. My mother's cooker was brought into the hotel. So that's how entrepreneurs start their businesses. So if you're a small person, SME, then you should be able to manage within that, I think, because having come from a background of an SME entrepreneur, I have seen how he has struggled, how he had to go through, you know, how the bigger companies were not allowing him to market Nigambo. Nigambo was considered a dirty destination. All the big companies never brought a single tour operator to Nigambo. But he managed to single-handedly make Nigambo a well-sought-after destination. So if individuals like that can, and I'm sure entrepreneurs, whether they are small, they have a certain amount of passion in them. That is why they have become entrepreneurs. And I have a lot of faith in the SME sector. And in Sri Lanka, also about 60% is made up of SMEs. So they can, they will survive. They will be, because they have the passion for the industry they are in. And I'm sure they will survive better than the bigger companies.
Fine. On that note, there is another question from Amanda Vedanayagam. Is also one element of restructuring or cutting costs is with regard to pay. Any other initiative that you all have done to reduce as part of restructuring your own cost levels? Anything else other than, which is obvious, the headcount issues?
Yeah, so we have renegotiated the rent.
Rent
with the larger amounts, you know, then power and energy is a big cost. Yeah, we have looked at minimizing. Then even simple things like telecommunication costs, you know, we may not be needing the fancy fiber optic cables anymore. So look at every single line item, I'm saying, all your cost items, look at them very carefully. And you'll be surprised at how much you can reduce. And those little amounts will really add up in the end. So don't only, yes, I agree with you, you don't only look at the headcount, look at all the other items. And yeah, I'm sure most of it you can reduce. And I mean, we have brought our cost down to by about 50% from what we were in March for April. So it can be done. Believe me, look at it carefully and you will do it.
Fine. What you're saying is you can't be very emotional in the current state.
Unfortunately not. I mean, being a woman, I think I am emotional, but you can't. I'm lucky I have Iran who will, you know, put me down and say, you know, this is it. You can't do this kind of thing, which is good. It's a good balance, I think.
Good.
See, Nista, also, the game is very tough, you know, so you can't just say, I'm going to stay to my focus. You know, some people are venturing out now. There are travel agents in Maldives who has got into agriculture. And I sent all the seeds from here to the guys so that they can, they are saying for the next 6 months, they're going to focus on agriculture. They don't have any experience. Second, they are saying they're going to start distribution. So I, in fact, got in touch with the FMCG company and they're going to start distributing product soaps. So I think you will have a total a change of a company's culture to survive the next 6 months. New things will have to be started. You know, some people have, I mean, you have distillery companies who have got into sanitizer. So, you know.
Anissa, one example I saw recently is one of the agents, very innovative thinking, put a nice Facebook advertisement saying that I have 30 well-trained people. And if you want to use them for any kind of back office or process management, please contact. And he had been contacted one whole agency. And they have got a full contract with one of the leading pharmacy chain to handle their back-end calls and get orders. And then that contract is running for about 3-4 months. So there are innovative things that needs to be done, but it's very sad. Also, the situation is that, you know, it's very clear everyone will not be able to survive. It's a truth. It's a harsh truth. Some will survive, some will half survive, some will not survive. So people who have actually looked at business from a risk perspective, what are the risks that I'm facing and how to mitigate that? And every business has a risk. Tourism has gone through like a huge amount of challenges in the past. We just recovered from April 21st April attacks, and then, you know, this time the tsunami and the airport attacks, the 30-year war. So people in the industry should actually know also to some extent how to actually balance this to some extent and then do it. But this kind of thing is difficult to manage, but it's sometimes inevitable that, you know, some of the, especially the people who the cash management is not properly done, and a lot of loans and, you know, we are basically stretched companies might find it very, very difficult to survive whatever they do at this moment.
I mean, I repeat, Nista, the biggest task that we should do now is to make sure that our staff do not get COVID. And that involves proper rigor, proper discipline. If we can do that for the next 2 months, I think that's the best service we can give our people, because if you get COVID, the family gets. And then the whole process falls on the ground. There is no tourism after that, you know, in your hotel.
Right. Understood. I think, can we focus on the rest of the stakeholders in the value chain, the handicraft seller, the fruit and vegetable supplier? I mean, what are you going to deal with? I mean, you used to deal with them, engage them productively. What has been the status since then? I mean.
Yeah, so we are dealing with them. And for example, as a company, we also do our training. We have on teams and things like that. We keep in touch with our teams because we are not meeting them anymore. But we do regular training. And at the same time, we are in touch with our suppliers as well. And the chauffeur guides and the guides who are freelancing. I think most of the chauffeur guides also need to be commended on. Because during the time when people, nobody, there were some guides who never wanted to do a tour. but there were others who fearlessly took tours even during that March period, and they took care. So they looked at it as their duty and their profession, and they did it. And unfortunately, one of our freelance shop guys also contracted, got the virus. Fortunately, he is out of danger. He's now out of the IDH. He's young, and he was able to get about out of it. So I agree with Rohanka that that is our main concern as well. We would not want anyone to get it. We do our utmost to also protect it. But there is a limit. I mean, if they get out on in a bus, we saw how when the curfew was lifted, how people got into vehicles. So I agree with him. We need to really have a program to educate people on how to get into public transport, how to get inside the lift, the do's and don'ts of everything. That is a given, Rohanta. I don't think there's any argument about that, you know, that we need to be safe first to run a business or to, you know, that is a given. Every organization does their best to educate their people. And then we also tell our people to try and educate your little community and carry on. But to answer your question, so the other peripheral people are also, we are in touch with them. Some of them have loans which they can't pay. So we are assisting them to go to banks. And I don't know whether banks are also at this point in time ready to do it, because they are also having a lot of NPLs and lots of issues. But in spite of it, we are saying, I mean, and everybody knows, you know, so a bank, if you have been a good customer, bank will look after you. I mean, no bank is going to let go of you. So we are engaging with them. And I'm sure all the other stakeholders are also engaging with their suppliers.
Dilip, Rohanta brought Maldives into the discussion. How is this? I mean, Maldives has managed to sort of be away from the whole negative press so far. Of course, there was a lockdown in Mali, but how are the resorts faring in the Maldives?
I think Maldives is also no better than Sri Lanka. So all the resorts are closed, and the situation in Mali is not very good either. It's just fast spreading now. And so they are not really, it's a lockdown scenario completely. And there isn't much of a very positive or negative publicity for them, but the fact that it is in Mali and the airports are not operating and the rest of the operations are difficult. So it's for the first time we have seen it after we have never seen that in the past, last 30 years, something like this. So I don't see Maldives is any better than Sri Lanka.
Actually, Mr., to be very honest with you, Maldives is in, if you look at the COVID cycle, they're in stage 4. So they have got into the community spread, and now the lockdown has happened, but it's too late. So now it's all about as to how we'll have to see what kind of strain has hit there, and whether, you know, that recovery process in terms of the ventilators and the number of beds are adequate. So as Dilip said, it's almost like the Colombo, you know, the Maradan area, where we're having stage 4 situation where we have to watch. So we're in that situation in Maldives.
Good. what's the key message for the hospitality industry from COVID? I mean, you know, what does it bring, reinforces to the industry? I mean, yes, we had faced several crises in the past. What new message is coming from COVID, Shiromal and Dilip?
Well, this is not the last crisis that we have to face, that's for sure. And we never thought once we finished, 21st April, you know, everyone was like, after 6 months, things are looking good, but we never thought this is going to come in. So you never know. The crisis is actually part and parcel of uncertainty of business. It's a part and parcel of the entire business cycle. So you need to keep that, factor that in. You have to have your business continuity plan. You need to have your risk assessment plans in place to mitigate to some extent. Some can, some cannot. The second thing is as an industry, we should keep in mind that the tourism will survive into medium to long term. Short term, yes, there's an impact, but if the holding power is there, if the rest of the elements in place, medium to long term, tourism has always bounced back. And that is the hope that we have currently, because human nature is such that, you know, people are looking always to travel and discover new destinations. But the forms of what this new tourism is going to be, it can be different. for example, classical tourism model that we had, business model might be completely challenged and might have an emergence of a new business model that we're coming, and that we need to be ready. And we had to look at it from an innovation point of view. And this is the time that we need to actually, what I told back earlier, is that we need to look at the purpose-driven tourism. Is this the time to bring in? In a time where the government has embraced and agreed after 10 years that this the global destination campaign is going to come in, it's very important that marketing itself can't actually rectify the situation from policy level. Industry together, that bring that purpose-driven tourism into table is something we need to work on.
Okay. No, just, okay, Easter Sunday was a more Sri Lankan problem, was a Sri Lankan situation. But I don't know whether the industry has faced a global, no country has been spared, and borders have been closed. I mean, this is totally new. I mean, there is much stronger message coming from this as opposed to Easter Sunday, which is a terror-related thing, which I think we have lived with in the past.
The message, Nisa, is that the crisis that we are going to face is going to be greater and greater every time. We never faced something like COVID, 21st April before we faced that. Now we face COVID-19 we never faced before. So the type of crisis that we have to face is going to be greater than before.
Okay. Ramal, any insights in terms of what's the message?
So I think they say it's like a world war, right? That everybody, the whole... just the economies, everything is getting impacted. So I think it just reinforces the fact that tourism is a very vulnerable industry. And because tourism deals with human beings are generally beings of emotion. So any little thing will affect tourism. So I think it just reinforces the fact that it is fragile, it is vulnerable. And we need to plan as much as possible, but there is a limit to how much one can plan, because a well laid out plan can become, you know, just get out of the window when something happens. But yeah, I think it just reinforces its vulnerability.
Okay.
If I add Nista to what Dilip and Shiromola are saying, this industry lives on the edge. I mean, all over the world. It's man-made, natural. The first industry to get attacked is tourism. So if you get into this industry, you must know that you must have a backup plan with you as to manage. The second point I just like to share is that I think what we should do in the short term is that we have to see how each of our properties are going to be COVID control environment. And if we can develop a certification process so that if I go to a Jetwing property in Yala, right, that it is COVID free. So that I think if Sri Lanka comes out of this, I mean, the first thing I will do is I want to go to Yala, you know? So will I stay?
I object in Yala,
you know what I'm trying to say, right? So I want to, but then which hotel do I stay? It is a COVID control hotel. So there are so many hotels there. So if I think the industry needs to quickly take this hold, because please, you have to understand that we don't know what the reality is, but there is almost 7% of the people who get COVID gets a repeat. So sometimes, you know, you can't look at the outside market right now. It's foolish to plan outside market. We'll have to look at domestic, because I don't know whether it's polio or whether we get the BSC, our injection, that we are somewhat, you know, kind of insulated, even for the short term. So we got to live till the first vaccine comes out. So that's our challenge. So if the vaccine will come out in another 6 months time, we have to live for 6 months. And that will be totally domestic market led is my view.
Okay.
Yeah, we agree with you, Rohanta. We need to, that is why I said we need to educate, train our teams again, because they're not even used to wearing the mask. The mask is something new to us, and getting somebody to wear it for 8 hours is not going to be easy. So we need to have shorter, quicker breaks. We need to look at lots of different things. I agree with you, Rohanta. And that is something most hotels are concentrating on now.
And Shirumar, practical things, like for example, you know, you have a sliding door, which you always push when you're going into, let's say, the kitchen, you know, from one to another. Now, that door has to come out now, because that is where the contact point of all the germs come. So we have to relook at our total properties to make it friendly and control-led.
Sure, sure.
Just...
I think, Nisa, to the point of Rohanta, I think all the hotels are now actually looking at what are the best health practice, health and safety standard practices that needs to be adopted in all the hotels. So that is being worked out currently, and we actually as a chain have put across a series of practices into that. And there are some best practices in various by various authorities. Hong Kong Hotel Association has put a very interesting document as on. So those are actually starting from your operation level, front as well as back of house areas. What are the best practices and the guidelines that needs to be established? And then of course it's important that, you know, government, if they do a certification of COVID-19 process, that's pretty good. That gives a confidence to the customer, not more than the customer. It's actually basic health and safety standards that needs to be established. So I think the hotels and the other actually will have to take those practices and implement in their hotels to ensure the safety of the people once the hotels actually start operating.
And also, Dilip, if I may add, I mean, if you take Sri Lanka, we have 6 million to households, of which if you look at the ABSCC group is 20%. So you're saying 1 million households, right? And if you're saying you'll have, I mean, say what, 8,000 to 12,000 5 and 4 star rooms. I mean, right now, the whole of Colombo is waiting to get out as soon as things are okay. So your hotels are the best locations, you know? So if we can hold ground with the flattening of the curve, you know, you guys will have business. At least we, all of us will have business.
Talking about domestic tourism, which was brought about, I mean, I know we have been talking a lot where previously they had salvaged the industry to a lot of to a large extent. And we are also talking about domestic tourism. I mean, what if you were to say three things that we haven't done before to promote domestic tourism, what would those three be? Romal and Dilip and Rohanta, maybe two things you feel that Sri Lanka could look at short term.
I think the first thing is to give the confidence for the travelers, especially, I mean, the domestic, there are various segments in domestic tourism. First of all, we need to give...
Assuming, talking about in a fairly safe environment, you know, one is, as Shruma said, people may not have the spending power, one is, because with all the pay cuts going, it's a middle class that travel or take through the holidays. So the affordability of a holiday is not going to be very convincing. So what will really trigger them to really go for this holiday, domestic tourist, between now and December?
I mean, we have seen it that Sri Lankan market always actually they are very, very responsive to the credit card offers, etc. So there's a price sensitivity in the market already established. We saw that this is happening after 9, especially on 21st April. Along with the prices, people, it's inevitable, the demand-supply situation. So it's a frequency is there, but domestic tourism can contribute if it is a weekend market around 20-30% of the total occupancy throughout the year. It's not more than that. The second thing which they can look at is that it's very important that, you know, the back of their mind is that you will not be able to run 100% or at least until the confidence is built in so that your certain amount of social distancing in restaurants and other places may be necessary. So that hotels might also not initially to run and fill the hotels immediately. So we have to give that confidence slowly. So that's why in the circle I mentioned earlier, first is to come the domestic tourism, and then you come the FITs and the other business traffic comes later before group travel comes into play at all.
Shilomal, any ideas? Just one or two, something new that they can...
Yeah, I think, you would spoke about the middle class, but I think now even the high net worths, the so-called high net worths, won't be traveling abroad, right?
Yes,
so as Rohanta said, there is going to be a pent-up demand and people want to just get away. So many of my friends have said, I just need to get out, I can't stay here anymore. But we need to act responsibly, as Rohanta said. Within those responsibility parameters, if we can provide safe places for people to go and stay, they are going to go. I'm very confident that our domestic market will travel, and the market segments will be different. There will be a certain segment going to the more exclusive boutique kind of hotels. There will be the others going into the middle range hotels. And then there's also the cheaper hotels that are available, accessible to all. We were talking about companies adapting. There is this platform called Yohobits, which is kind of a informal sector platform that is dealing mainly with the domestic market. they immediately converted into a thing called Yohoman, and they are now starting to deliver products to people. So the Sri Lankans are also very agile and very flexible in their ability. So I'm sure the different segments will be fairly well taken care of. As Dilip said, it's about 20 to 30%, and it may be only a weekend travel, but still it will be fairly significant.
Okay. Just on the domestic.
Mr. In my view, I think we are coming to some very interesting times, because I know we have been doing some traditional marketing, each of these tourist properties, but you have a captive market of about 500,000 to 700,000 households who travel overseas, and they are looking at top end. Now that group is waiting to get out, but they will not go to traditional hotels. They would want to go in for very experience-driven hotels. So, I mean, you might have very strong brands, the top five properties, but you would see that sometimes they will not be able to attract this target group, because they will be wanting to go into small places, and you know they want to stay away from crowds. So you might have to change your model if you want to survive in the next 6 months. There is no option; it has to be done.
Okay. Yeah. Just taking on a suggestion from one of the participants, to boost local tourism, can we make longer weekends with Friday, Saturday, Sunday as off days?
No, this year is exceptional. There are so many more weekends which are taking place. There was also suggestion that, you know, why don't we make it a tax free? All the domestic spending that is done in hotels, etc. So these are yet to be seen how it's going. But this year has significant amount of long holidays compared to last year.
Mr. In my view, I think now everybody has started working remote.
Yeah.
And it has become a new way of life, you know. So you might have that 500,000 to 700,000 households who travel overseas, who might want to actually go out of their home, which is much more safer in a location. And you might not have actually Friday to Monday. You might have a situation like where you take Wednesday to Sunday off, you know. But you're working, remote working. Huh? So it's going to be a working holiday.
Right.
There are a few questions to Shiromal in terms of Chinese. I can't really understand what is to Chinese. Hold on. Okay, there is one talk. I'll take the other questions. Shouldn't the industry standardize safety? I think, Dilip, you mentioned about guidelines coming out, but that's from the health authorities. Can you, going forward, will there be some standards?
No, I think every, except now, I think all hotel chains are working their own set of guidelines based on best practices and what is available and what has been put forward, especially as I mentioned to you, the Hong Kong Tourism Association has done, Hotel Association has done a very good document. So they are adopting to the local context. So anticipating that, the health authorities also most probably will give certain guidelines, especially when you're having banquets and restaurants and so on. So we'll have to put that together, keeping in mind the entire operation of the hotel. The safety is paramount, and we also have a responsibility in doing that. So that has to look at all 360 operation of the hotel. So if that is in place, and if that can be also be certified by a certain body, then that would give an additional coverage, additional some sort of a comfort for the people who are coming into the hotels.
Okay. The Shiromal, the question is, can you work with Sri Lanka Tourism to organize or reorganize the Chinese market that we're talking about, that we are getting the wrong Chinese?
Maybe we should do it with SLITO, the Association of Inbound Tour Operators. We should, yes, definitely. That may be, that's a good point. We should work at that.
Right. We have a few more minutes to wrap it up. I just want to ask just one question. There is this question of these three markets, China, Germany, Italy, UK, which will help in terms of recovering faster, our source markets?
I would think China initially. I think China.
Okay. So
I think China would be the European markets will take longer to come back.
Okay, so for the Chinese tourists, if we have been getting or if we have been riding on the wrong set of Chinese here, then to get the right Chinese, what do we need to do?
We need to market, have a campaign.
Get these Chinese to do what here, or what kind of things those high-end Chinese, high-yielding Chinese really look for in a destination?
But they love shopping, and we have, especially gems and jewelry, they do a lot of shopping, teas and other things. So we have it, and as Dilip said, they are also brand conscious. But I don't know post-COVID how their buying patterns will be, because people are now getting a lot used to online buying and all of that. But that's another conversation. But the Chinese were spending, the people who came. But the whole industry was going in a different way. So if that can be streamlined and brought into the mainstream, and if the SLTDA can have some guidelines to control these people, even the guiding, there were Chinese nationals coming to Sri Lanka and guiding. So lots of issues that need to be corrected. And if that can be done, as to say, this is the ideal time for that. And I think we can, and New Zealand has done an excellent example of getting the right Chinese client coming there. Australia is another country. So there are even Thailand, they were also getting the zero based tourists, but they are not getting that anymore. They have also changed their style. So we can learn best practices from other people and adapt them.
I feel that we need to be very, very careful how we venture out to get people from overseas for tourism. We have to be extra cautious now. I mean, for example, if you take China, maybe the safest place right now would be Wuhan and nowhere else. So we'll have to look at maybe city-wise to understand what the characteristics are, and then see whether there is some merit that can come in. But the most important criteria would be health, because otherwise what's going to happen is that those kinds of hygiene and sanitation levels, if it is slightly different when a Chinese comes, and if it comes into the country and then it creates a second wave, Sri Lanka's economy is too small to take this hit. The second point I just like to share is that, you know, last year we grew by 2.5%, but like some of the companies that I work for in the FMCG sector, we grew by 25%. Volume growth, huh? Okay. World Bank is saying that we'll be -3 to about -5 is what their estimate is. So from an economic point of view, it's not a huge wave, though we know that this COVID is huge across the world. In Sri Lanka, the impact would be much, much lesser. So the most important focus area is to look at our source of business and see how we can protect that source of business. So, if you are biased towards a particular country, get into that country, understand from where you're going to source it, so that then, and prepare the plan so that when the market opens out, you're ready to go there, you know?
Good. Just taking a few questions before, any guidelines for short-term guidelines for DMCs? Destination management companies, any coming up?
Ranta, you want to take that?
I think you need to just diversify and don't look at sticking to the market. Look at as to what are the new things that can be done with your property in terms of getting that revenue in. If you have to turn, otherwise, if you're not going to do that, you're not going to survive. Very simple, because this industry doesn't make money. It makes money on asset enhancement.
quick answer from the panel. Should we go back? Should we be having a minimum room rate once again?
No, not from me. No from me.
I don't think it's... market forces should decide what's the best rate. That's the best way forward.
Okay, so there is no that, because you will have people coming back and making the same arguments going forward to enhance revenue.
It's a very debate. It's a very sensitive question currently in the industry. So some are yes and no. So, but our opinion is it's good to market forces to decide that.
Right. Somebody said that this is the ideal opportunity to get the policy right. You think some of these contentious issues can we put it on put for much more constructive discussion and industry agree so that there is no deviation in the future? You think that this is a good opportunity?
I think it is, but right now everybody's on a survival mode, you know, loans and all of that surviving. So I think next phase will be that would be the next phase for sure.
Okay, fine.
No, I think it's encouraging to see, especially UNDP support that is given to SLTDA and the steps that are some of the steps that were actually articulated yesterday and before in some of the newspapers in your newspaper as well. Some of these initiatives actually will contribute in a medium to long term that, you know, that we need. So if those actually been implemented and designed, those are actually very good decisions in the right direction that we really need. The last master plan that was done by UNDP for Sri Lanka was done in 1980. So it's almost 40 years back. We need those things to move forward. You know, everyone is, I think, talking about this COVID. It's very important. But the next year, believe me, mark my date, same day, you might be talking about how to handle these stories.
Thank you. I think our time is up. Thank you very much for the panel. But any last, so basically the conclusion is that you think it's a long-term recovery. It takes 6 to 8 months, maybe 12 months. That's confirmed, is it? That's the general industry feeling, okay?
Right. Yes.
And till we, it's the domestic tourism that will initially kick into the industry. As you mentioned, that we have got, after 10 years, we got the destination marketing strategy or consensus. What do you think government should do? I mean, not many things, but one thing that you feel government should do it to help the industry. One thing that you feel it has done a lot. But one thing more.
Just facilitate, I think. They should be the enabler.
Okay.
And also to, I think, consider positively the requests that have been put forward by the industry association, hotel association, the Flyto, and all the other associations. Those comments are very valid and needy. So any positive consideration for those points will be very much helpful for the industry.
Okay. For Minister is... since I worked on T-Board, export development, my only request is that the industry get together this time, see what the best practices that the apparel and tea has done in the last 5 years, and just emulate that same strategy, your industry is going to really succeed. I mean, the last campaign that we did, I think, Dilip, you were, I think, MD at Tourism Promotions Bureau, and I was on the technical committee. I mean, that was the last campaign I saw where the industry got together and did some work globally for promotions. You know, so I think we have to do that this time. But if we lose this, this is the fifth time that Sri Lanka tourism has lost. We lost the 2009 war after the Easter attack. You know, I can keep on counting how the industry has continued to be pulling things from different directions, but it has not happened in the tea industry. However competitive it is, the industry got together, we did a marketing plan, and then we launched the global campaign. So was in the apparel sector and the IT BPO sector. So I think this industry has to get together and do it this time and not lose this chance.
Okay, excellent. Thanks for all the comments. I have to apologize to all the participants whose questions haven't been answered, but I hope we'll have further discussion on the industry. I'd like to thank the two organizers, the European Chamber of Commerce of Sri Lanka, as well as the Chartered Institute of Logistics and Transport, for bringing this panel together. Very interesting insights, and I'm sure there's a lot of key takeaways from the discussion. And I'd like to thank each of the panelists, as Shiromal, Dilip, and Rohanta, for their time. And also our technical partner, International Institute of Knowledge Management, for providing this platform to have this rethinking tourism post-COVID. Thank you very much, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Yeah.